Good morning, Journey. How are you guys this morning? Good. Well, can you guys stand with us? We're going to start off by singing a song about how God is worthy. And even in any situation in our life, He is worthy.
Be exalted now in the heavens. You know, let's just stay in this moment and proclaim the name of Jesus over our lives and over all the things that seem to be coming against us, the sickness and the divisiveness, the depression, the stuff. Because Jesus, his name is above that, right? His name is above that. So let's just close our eyes right now. Let's lift our hands to the heavens and let's just proclaim. Let's literally speak with our mouth the name of Jesus over our lives, our family, our businesses, our jobs. Maybe there's a lot coming against your work, your business, and right now you just need to proclaim the name of Jesus over your business, over your school, over your classroom, over your body. Over cancer and COVID. There's no other name. That you know what that means? That means there's no other name. There's no other name. So Lord, we declare together, affirm with you that every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus, say it with me, that Jesus Christ is Lord. That every knee will bow and every tongue confess, say it, that Jesus Christ is Lord. Lord, we're gathered as a group of people that are intentionally living under the Lordship of Jesus Christ and inviting others to do the same, because that's where life is. So we proclaim that over our own lives and over everything that's coming against us and our family and our world right now. So, we pray in the name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. All right, spin around and say hi to somebody, and then a video will come to set up our series. Cassie. Pretty good? It's good to be back with you guys. Do you miss me? I missed you, so thanks, yeah. Well, but man, we had a great run of, wasn't July awesome? Like we had such a wide diversity of people and words and stuff, and it was funny how different they were, and then for every one, I had different ones of you coming up saying, man, that's the best message I ever heard. I'm like, well, first of all, thanks a lot. And secondly, yeah, you're right. It's awesome. So anyways, so my name's Ed. I'm one of the pastors here. And if you're at home, yay, welcome to you too. And when you came in, you got a card with like information on one side and an outline on the other. Do you guys have that? Yes? You'll need that. Before I get into this too much, first of all, part of worship is giving. And you can give in a variety of ways. We're still not doing the pass the thing around, like traditional church stuff, because of everything. And so, you don't even need to get into it anymore, just because of everything, right? And so, for those of you that are in the room, there's boxes right there and out in the door. You can actually drop offerings in there, or you can go online and set up something, you know, like an automatic thing, which is a great way to do it. Or you can use your phone and our app and give that way. Or I'm sure there are other ways. I can't think of them right now. So, but we'd love for you to participate and partner with us in that if this is your church. And so the other thing, the big thing that before I get into the message, is every year we set aside two different weeks to really bear down and concentrate and turn our attention to the Lord and seek the Lord together with weeks of prayer. And so in the summer, we do that at the two beginnings of the year. You know how there's the calendar year that's the beginning of the year, and then there's the unofficial beginning of the year, of the other year, the school year. Even though you're, you know, like for me, it's been years since I've even had kids in school. So it's like, you know, but it still feels like, okay, this is a year starting. So what we're doing this week, right? It's this week, is we have prayer gatherings. Like we have our Friday service, of course, and then Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, we have prayer gatherings here. And we would love for you to be a part of all three of those. And just say to yourself right now, I really need to step my game up. I do, and I'm excited to be at those. And so that'll be at 6:30, those three nights. And then the other thing that we're doing is that we'll have we call it 24/7 prayer. So I think it's actually started today. Am I right about that? Yes? Anybody know stuff? I should know stuff before I get up here, but I'm gonna work. That's my resolution for the new year. But the deal is, it's like every one of us picks an hour, and we're like, okay, I got. It's kind of like a prayer wall. It's like, all right, this is my spot on the wall. I got this one, and it's the reason I really want you to do that is for many of you, praying for an hour straight sounds formidable. Like, how can anyone do that? Like, you know, all right, God, now what do I do? Do I just get there's not even phone books anymore. You just get it out and start praying for the people. I mean, what are you going to do, right? So, but we give you a guide, and we break it down into 12 5-minute segments, and it's actually a really powerful time, and it'll affect your devotion life moving forward. So I really would love for you to take advantage of that. And you can still sign up for an hour. What would be cool is if you picked an hour that's not already taken. You could pick any hour. We'll sign you up. We'll have 10 people on 1 hour. But some of you, you can imagine that, you know, Wednesday at 4 in the morning is wide open probably right now, you know. So we'd love for you to take one of those. You good? Huh? All right. Is it you or me? What's going on here? It's like you're a little slow. The deal is, and I say this every year it seems, but boy, it seems like more than ever, we need to seek the Lord. Like we need God. We need God in this moment of our history, right? And we need God in our lives. It seems like, man, I just with us, I hear stuff every week that just makes me feel like my knees are going to buckle with all the stuff that just those of us in this room are dealing with. It's gnarly. So anyways, I say let's pray and see what happens. Anybody with me on that? Yeah? Let's do it. Let's do it. Yeah. Yeah, somebody's clapping. They should clap for that. So anyways, here we go on the message. So as you can see from that little fingerprint thing and the video deal, we're starting a series on the topic of identity. It's the next few weeks we're going to be doing with this. And I'm going to say this, you know, you kind of assume there's going to be some kind of a pitch here for you. And here it comes. Like there's hardly anything I can think of that's going to affect, actually affect your life more than this topic. It's one of those issues that affects almost every other issue that your family and friends and you and your world you deal with. And it shapes the rest of how you do life. It shapes kind of how you feel, like just day to day, how you feel about things, about your ability to trust God, your ability to hear from God, your ability to worship freely. A lot of you, when we get to these worship moments, when we're singing and stuff, there's always a little something in you that kind of that kind of like snags. You know, you get to a certain place or a certain lyric and you're feeling yourself getting caught up and it's like you're snagged on something. That's rooted in identity. And a lot of times the problems with like your whole, I don't know how to say this exactly, your whole Christian deal, right? Like how this is working out for you are rooted in the fact that you've never squared away this area. Like it's still, this idea is still off, and therefore you're trying to fix stuff downstream that's like you got the foundation off and you're trying to fix, you know, like the window coverings, you know. It's kind of like you want to skip to the third trimester of pregnancy. Well, you kind of can't. You got to start with the other ones, right? I shouldn't use that illustration, having never been pregnant or anything. I assume it's easy. But we've had three kids. It was easy for me. Anyways, I think there's our friend Chris Gore, when he was here a couple months ago, he said this, and he said it. This is from his book, Apprehended Identity. We don't become, remember when he said this? This is a huge statement. We don't become what our Father, what God thinks of us. We actually become what we think our Father thinks of us. That's about identity. And his book, I would really recommend it to you. It's for those of you that aren't big book readers, it's short. I'll give you, it gets right to the point and it's pretty readable. It's Apprehended Identity, really good book. And see, it's like, and here's the thing. Here's how you know this is important. Because all the evil that is coming against you, the devil, if you were, understands that this is the win or loss. This is a destiny shaper for you. This area will shape your destiny. And the devil understands that. And so I've got this little slide here about identity under attack. See, the devil understands that here's how evil comes against you in any area, but in this area in particular, is the Bible kind of, at times it talks about it like this, the devil, the world, and the flesh. Some of you might be familiar with that kind of thought, that's what the thing coming against you, the opposition you feel as you try to move forward in life, like we all feel that, right? This opposition, well, it comes in three forms, the devil himself, and then it does. And when it comes to identity, the devil is constantly undermining. In fact, we're going to look at this next week. This was the vintage, the original sin, and the original temptation was about identity. And then it doesn't help matters that we have a world that we're living in, a culture, a zeitgeist, if you will. The esprit de corps in the room right now. Complicating the issue is the fact we live in a culture that is trying to shape our thinking about identity and where it comes from into anything except, anything but what God says. And so here's the deal. Our culture seems to have a vested interest in you staying ignorant and staying adrift and staying unanchored. And so in the culture, like all the time in the media, all the time on social media, all the time as you watch TV and all that, there's messages constantly coming that undermine your identity or that give you false clues. Like say, oh, look this way. It's kind of like you ever see that movie? It was great. I love war movies, World War II movies. There's a movie, a classic called Battle of the Bulge. It's an epic, like, I think it's like 3 hours of awesomeness, you know what I mean? And if you don't like it, it's 3 hours of torture. But it's like one of the things that was happening as our forces were advancing in Europe was that the Germans would come and redo the signs, like the road signs, so that at least that's what happened in the movie. I don't know if that actually happened, but the movie, it was like, you know, just try to get us off course. That's what's happening. And then the biggest one, if you guys could put that slide back up there, is this thing the Bible calls the flesh. The Greek word in the New Testament is sarx for that. And it means your physical and to some degree your physical and psychological being. But think of your flesh, like if you were reading the Bible in Spanish, you know what the word flesh would be? Anybody? Carne, right? Your carne. Carne asado, hopefully not, right? So, yeah, I love that. You know, Sam, maybe, me too. But it just kind of gets us off track. But here's the thing. What happens is this. Lots of our identity problems are rooted in conclusions that our brains have made, thoughts and reflections on the various things that have happened to us and the various ways that our life has gone. And the things, especially the early things that people, especially our parents, said to us. And that, like, plants stuff in our head. One of the things that you hear that's now, like, common, we talk about it, like, just it's a common word now, is the word synapse, right? It used to be, nobody knew what that was, but now everybody knows, right? You know what it is. It's like there's two different points in your brain, you know, like two different neurons, and the connection between those is a synapse. And what we've learned about brain, I'm no neurologist here, I just play one at church, but what we've learned about this is that the more you think a thought, the bigger and deeper, and it's like it carves a groove in your brain. It's like it things go from, like, if you just think a thought once, it's like, okay, it's there. But you think that same thought again, it's like, ooh, that connection is, and then you think it every day, over and over again, and next thing you know, that thing is a neurological superhighway. It's your default. It's like a rut that everything falls into. So you can think of it like this. Some of the stuff that's like when you're feeling bad, those kind of negative thoughts, those messages about you and about who you are, that's the flesh. That's kind of one of the things that gets sowed into you. And the devil's involved in that. The world's involved in that. When I was a kid, I think I've told you many times, our family did not go to church. And we acted like people that don't go to church. I mean, when I say we didn't, it could be before I have memories, they were faithful church attenders. They weren't, but I mean, that's possible, I guess. But I have no memories of ever going into a church, ever. So, my dad had a extensive swearing vocabulary that he used freely with us as kids. And I never thought a thing of it. You know what I mean? I never thought, oh, this is horrible. I knew that if I talked like that, I was in trouble. But I knew my dad, you know, it was the old thing you've heard comedians say, until I thought my name was Jesus Christ until I was 7 years old, because my dad was like, Jesus Christ, what's the matter with you? And it's like that kind of stuff, right? So that was me and my family. But and with all that stuff that my parents would say, there's one little thing that they say that if you're a parent, you fully understand this. You've said this to your kid. I promise you, in a weak spot, you've probably said this. But one of the things that stuck in me that still is like a synapse deeply carved is both my dad and my mom, when they were exasperated with me, which was daily, hourly, right, my poor mom, was this. They would say, Eddie, what's the matter with you? You're like, well, that's not that bad. And you're right, it's not that bad, right? It's really not that bad. But for some reason, for me, that said, wow, good question. Clearly something. What might that be, you know? I think also it was reinforced by, didn't Mo always say that to Curly? What's the matter with you? You know, it's like, what's the matter? And then when I got into my teenage years, and I would be asked, what's the matter with you? And then I would, you know, your teenage self's like, I don't know, bad parenting? It's like, you know, it's like, but that was not a wise choice, but you can't help yourself, right? See, the world, the flesh, the devil, it's, so how does it do this? How does it undermine your identity? And here's the answer, ready? This is the idea of today's. So we're going to have three messages, and then our friend John Lynch is going to be here. And at the end of the month, and then, yeah, that'll be fun. And And here's how this, the world of flesh and the devil, is that the world and all of these things combined together, to think of it this way, to hand me a faulty identity script. Here's your script. Here's the part you're going to play. This is your part in this. It's kind of like, if you're old enough, I don't think they still do this in school, but when I was in grade school, we had school plays where the whole class had to be in the play. Did you guys, and then your parents would have to come and suffer through that, and some of you, maybe you were the kind of kid that always was the main, and then some of us were just like, listen, just, you're the tree, just stand there, you know what I mean, or whatever. Try not to screw that up, you know, but the deal is, it's like you get a script. Here, this is your part. And the deal, the thing is, even if the world and your all the even if the script that you have is relatively better than somebody else's, it's still, without God, it's a faulty identity script. And here's the funny thing. It, on the one hand, it forces you into a mold. It doesn't take into account that God has a different script for everybody. But on the other hand, evil has custom tailored your faulty script for you based on your wounds, your trauma, your background. For example, have you noticed that some people, and maybe you are this person, a certain kind of trouble seems to find you all the time? Have you noticed that? If you, maybe you've been verbally, maybe you're always like a person that is on the wrong end of, well, there's no right end, of verbal abuse, of people treating you like, doesn't it seem weird that the people who are in that, it's like they keep getting into those situations. That's not an accident. That is in part the devil and in part the world reinforcing this faulty script. This, many of us, it's the loser script, or the, here's a religious version, the you're a filthy sinner script. I can't believe God loves you. You're just lucky. You're lucky he hasn't zapped you yet, script. We just, some of our staff team, we just went through the Global Leadership Summit. This week is 2 days of speakers and leadership type people. And there's a woman, I had never heard of this, but I asked, Cassie was there, and I asked her if she has, and she's like, oh, of course. There's this cosmetics called It Cosmetics. Guys, you've all heard of that, right? Anyways, apparently it's a very big deal. And it was started by a woman named Jamie Kern Lima. She had like a skin condition. She was kind of in, working her way through the media in front of a camera, and they kept, you know, but her skin condition was kind of messed up. So she thought, what would makeup look like for somebody like me who's doesn't have good skin, who has good skin, quote unquote. And so she developed this product and just thought, I think what if there was a kind of makeup product that basically said to women, you're beautiful as you are. You know, we're not going to show you these airbrushed people to advertise. We're going to show you real people and blah, blah, blah. So she had this idea and she pitched it, and her and her husband sank everything they had into this business idea, and they were pitching it to everybody and getting just no after no after no after no. And she finally got a meeting with these venture capitalists, I believe in the Bay Area, and she's up there and she thinks this could save us. If they invest in us, I think this will take us over the edge. And so she's, you know, they're down to a few thousand bucks in their checking account. And like, this, like, it's either keep the business going or pay the rent. And they have this great meeting. She could tell it's going great. And they get to the end, and the guy, the, the, the VC guy there says, you know what, congratulations, this is a great product. You have developed a great product, but we're gonna pass. And she said it was like just, she got kicked in the stomach, and she said, can I ask why? And he said, do you really wanna know? She said, yes, I do. And so he said this, we just don't think women will wanna buy cosmetics from somebody that looks like you and has your body type. Whoa, right? There was somebody saying, listen, you think you've got this, and she's a Christian, has been praying about this and feeling like God's leading her in this business adventure, and she's got this script that feels like it came from God, but there was this supposedly well-meaning person going, no, see, you need to get back in your lane, lady. You don't belong in this. Want to hear the end of the story? She ended up selling her business to L'Oreal for $1 billion, with a B. Yeah, that's pretty cool, right? That's pretty cool. She said, it's really fun when the people that were saying no to you and all that before are now calling you boss. That's kind of nice. And so here's the deal, right? This should have been on your outline, but we couldn't fit it. Here's the main idea of today's message. Our identity, which is designed to be a foundation and an energizing source of strength. That's how God wants your identity to work for you, to be like an energizing source of strength. It gets compromised when we accept and live out a faulty script. So when we go ahead and accept the you suck script, the you need to look like this for this to happen script, when the you're not enough script, then our identity gets compromised. That's the main way that it's under attack. And a lot of us are probably thinking, yeah, I kind of get this, but I know there's a God script for me, but I keep, man, that synapse is deep in my head. Ed, I keep falling, anybody can relate to this? I keep falling back into my bad script. Like every time I fall or stumble or sin or something, I feel like I'm back in my old script. And you experience what we might call the battle of the scripts. And so, and we're gonna look at that today. And this is this vividly portrayed in the story of King David. It's the most, maybe the most, the top five most famous stories in the Bible. We've done numerous messages on this very story. But, and so here comes another one. But here's the idea. Here's what's going on in this battle of the scripts. Maybe you've never thought of the David and Goliath story as a battle of the scripts, but it kind of is. So God has this guy who is the first king of Israel. His name is Saul. And Saul is a person that everybody would assume would have the king script on him. He's tall. He's good looking. What they basically want in a king is a guy to lead the army and get these Philistines off their rear ends. And so Saul seems to fit that bill. But the thing is, this isn't just any nation. This is the people of God. And so Saul keeps insisting on the script that is the it's all about me script. That's a bad script, by the way. The egocentric narcissist script. That's not a good script. And Saul is running that script. And finally, God's had enough and says, I'm going to remove that guy. And there's a guy that I'm looking for that is, here's the famous phrase, a man after my own heart. That's God saying to Samuel. Samuel is the national prophet. And so after he finally says, okay, Saul's done. And Saul's still the king, but God's going, we're moving on. And he says, now here's what I want you to do to the prophet. He says to Samuel, I want you to go to this tiny little village named Bethlehem, okay, the house of bread, Bethlehem. And I want you to find a guy named Jesse. And isn't it funny that God tells him those specifics, but he doesn't tell him which. He just says, one of his sons, that's the guy I want you to pour the oil on his head. this one of these kids, right? So he goes to this insignificant village and finds this peasant and says, okay, the prophet's in town. He's never there. And so they're going to have a big town-wide feast. And Samuel says, okay, we're not starting anything until I get some time with that guy in his house. And so he says, all right, listen, I need to see your sons because one of them is the one. And so here we go, right? It says, if you want to open your phone to 1 Samuel 16, a lot of this will be on the screens. But so they entered into the house and they looked at, and he starts parading his sons. And the oldest one is a guy named Eliab. And Samuel took one look at this cat and says, yeah, surely the Lord's anointed is before me. But the Lord said to Samuel, do not look at his appearance or the height of his stature. We already ran that play, Samuel. That's how we got Saul. So we're not doing it that way anymore. Because God says, I have rejected him. For God sees not as man sees. For man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. That's a really huge verse in the Bible, by the way. You might want to memorize that if you haven't. God sees not as man sees. Man looks at the outward appearance. And boy, do we make mistakes, don't we? Look, how many mistakes have you made looking at, you know, someone's outward appearance and assuming stuff about them? Then Jesse, the dad, calls the number two. He's got eight kids, so this might take a while. And it's a guy named Abinadab. And they made him pass before Samuel. He said, the Lord hasn't chosen him either. Next, Jesse calls his third son, Shema, which means something about listening. And this time Samuel's actually listening. And he says, no, this isn't the one either. Then Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And he's like, okay, this is our last chance. But Samuel said to Jesse, the Lord has not chosen any of these. And Samuel, listen to this. Samuel, the guy who doesn't know you, he just met you. Samuel says to the dad, this is so bad, it's funny, right? He says to the dad, is this it? You sure you don't have another son? Isn't that crazy? And Jesse says, well, we do have one other guy. It can't be him, right? He goes, he's the youngest. He's the eighth. It's not even, it's not even cool. Seventh, if you're the seventh son, that's kind of like you end up in a blues song, you know, or something. But it's like, you're the eighth. You're just that kid. It's like Samuel, it's like Jesse and his wife are like, man, we really want a girl. It's like, bro. Eight son, you know, come on. At some point, it's just not in the cards. But anyways, so there remains yet the youngest, and behold, he is tending the sheep. There's a citywide feast. That means everybody in the city, right? Except, apparently, David, right? Then Samuel said to Jesse, send and bring him here. We're not going to eat until he comes. So he sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and beautiful, with beautiful eyes and a handsome appearance. And the Lord said, that's the one. Arise, anoint him. That means pour the shemen, the oil on his head. That's what anoint means. For the Lord said, this is the one. Then Samuel took the horn of oil. And a horn of oil is like a hollowed out cow horn or something, some kind of animal horn. They hollow it out, they pour oil, it's like it contains liquid, and then you put a leather top on it, as it were. And he took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon him mightily. And David, from that day forward, and Samuel arose and went to Ramah. So here's the thing, right? There's this pattern that you see in the Bible. This pattern of God, I mean, it is, from almost from the start to the end of God choosing the unlikely. You guys have noticed that, right? I mean, it's like every, Dad, God's like, I'm going to start a whole nation full of people. What's God going to do? Choose a guy that's too old and is unable to have kids. You know what I mean? And then he's going to, and he keeps doing stuff like that, you know, and just every single time. And so this is the pattern. It's like, which kid? Let's get the eighth one. The one that, listen to this, the one that the dad doesn't even think to bring in. The guy that doesn't know your family says, you sure you don't have another son? And you say, well, I got that. Like, what? You think you've got self-esteem problems, right? So here's the deal. David is living the eighth son script. His family assigned it to him. Eighth son. The we wish you were a girl script, right? The okay, now we give up script, right? So here. And so you're with the sheep, which isn't necessarily bad. It's just, and here's what we see happening all the time in the Bible is when God finds these unlikely, there's the first principle, and it's this, that God interrupts and replaces the faulty script with the anointed script. That's a huge point, that God interrupts and replaces the faulty script with the anointed script. If God doesn't interrupt, you would live out the faulty script your entire life. You're never going to just, you can improve things, you know, with motivation and positive thinking and all that. All that's great, by the way. Good on it. But that's not what we're talking about. God interrupts and says, Samuel, this guy's living the eighth son script. Here's what he's going to start. Starting today, pour the oil on his head, and he's going to live the script of the guy that is anointed to be the next king of Israel script. The guy who had oil poured on his head in front of his brothers by the national prophet script. That's his new script. It's a script of partnership. Do you notice the part the Holy Spirit came upon him from that day forward? It's a script of power and significance. It's a script that says, you will make an impact on this world. People will name their kids after you 3,000 years from now, like I did my son. So often this happens in the scripture. It is so profound that God like just changes your name from that point on, just to make sure you don't forget your new script. So you're thinking, if you're a normal person, you would expect that his family would go, whoa, David, dude, wow, God's doing something here. Okay, man, when you say his name, you put some respect on it, right? You would expect that, but this is a real, actual family. So other things happen, right? So then we're gonna skip a little forward, and as the story's being written, the next big thing in the story is the David and Goliath thing. Although when they start the story, it's just the Goliath story. And so what happens is there's this place that we always go when we go to Israel, usually on the first full day that we're there because it's not that far from Tel Aviv. There's the Ella Valley. And it's really cool because it's undeveloped, which is, I would expect there would be like slingshot shops there and all kinds of stuff, right? But no, it's literally a farm. Like there's a big plowed field and everything is just like you would think. It's a valley. There's a hill over here that's way up there, and that's where the Israelites were like all dug in. And then you look over and there's still some Philistine ruins from like that are, you know, like 1,000 BC that are over there, and that's where the Philistines were. And there's a valley right between, and there's a dry, and it usually, we always go in the fall, so it's a dried up stream, a wadi, but it's got these rocks about yay big that, like, you know, when they say sling, it didn't mean slingshot, it meant a thing that you put in a pouch and whoosh, like that, it makes that noise. I think you should be impressed with the sound effect. So here we go, right? And so chapter 17, I'll just read some to you before it comes on the screen. Now the Philistines gathered their armies for battle, and they were gathered at Sukkot, which belongs to Judah, and they camped between Sukkot and Azekah in Ephesus. And Saul and his men of Israel were gathered and camped in the valley of Elah, and they drew up in battle array to encounter the Philistines. So they're on one side, they're on the other side, and there's a guy, Goliath, who is like Shaq O'Neal with another foot and a half. Like, he's that size, all right? And so, and in general, I think we can assume that in the ancient world, the average person was a little smaller than they are today, all right? So, huge dude, right? And he is saying, hey, let's do this. Why don't one of you guys come and fight me? And then if I lose, we'll be your slaves. We'll surrender. And if you lose, you surrender and you'll be our slaves. And he's walking, and then he's cursing God and cursing the people of Israel and all this stuff. And this goes on for every day at the same time. He walks out there and says, who's going to fight? I thought you guys were here for a war. Let's have a war. Let's start with me. Come on, who's ready? And of course, nobody wants to do this because they're probably going to lose. And so day after day, 40 days, this goes on. And so here's the part that I think is germane for us, right? It describes Goliath and all the armor and his weaponry and all this, you know, state-of-the-art stuff and, you know, and what a bad A kind of dude he was. And the Philistine, I defy the ranks of Israel and their God. So here he goes on. Now, here's the part that's going to be on the screen. Now, David was the son of Ephrath of Bethlehem in Judah, whose name was Jesse. We already know that, right? He had 8 sons. And Jesse was old in the days of Saul, advanced in years among the men. The 3 older sons of Jesse had gone after Saul, right? And we just met those in the last chapter. And the names of his 3 sons that went to the battle were Eliab the firstborn, and the second Abinadab, and the third was that guy Shema. And David was the youngest. Now the 3 oldest followed Saul. National emergency. The nation, the future of the nation is on the line. One of your kids was anointed by the prophet as the next king of Israel. So if, of course, you think he ought to be there because that's his script. But what does dad have him doing? Now, David was the youngest. Now, the 3 oldest followed Saul. But David went back and forth from Saul to tend his father's flock at Bethlehem. And David came forward morning and evening the Philistine came forward morning and evening for 40 days. Then Jesse said to David, take now your brothers an ephah of roasted grain. In other words, he had David just running supplies. Just, you know, it's back in the day. So if you want food, your family's got to bring it to you. And wars were never like way over there. Like, this was like, if you lose, you move, right? They take your city. And so here's the deal. So David is, it says, then Jesse said to his son David, take now for your brothers an ephah of this roasted grain and these 10 loaves and run to the camp to your brothers. Bring also these 10 cuts of cheese, grow up, to the commander of the thousands and look into the welfare of your brother. I'm trying to have church here, all right? Can you just mature a little bit? And bring back news of them, for Saul and they are the men of Israel. Here's a little principle you should probably notice, that it's the family principle when it comes to your script. Sometimes, maybe what we should say is often, usually, always, all right? Sometimes, even in good families, you have to look right through the voices of your family to live your script. And here's what's happening here. It's not like your family is against you. They're not. They're just used to a certain script. They're comfortable with that. And when God, look at what was happening here. God was doing something historic in their little brother's life, but they just were like, yeah, just, no. No, 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 no. No, think about this. When you have 8 kids, that means your oldest brother is somewhere in the neighborhood of what, 12, 13 years older than you? So you're 16. Your brother's 32, probably married, and he has his own. All right. So eventually, here's the story. eventually world, so David, well, I've skipped over too much. So let me read a little more. So David arose early in the morning and let the flock with a keeper, like his dad sent him to bring this stuff to his brothers. And he went as Jesse had commanded him. And he came to the circle of the camp while the army was going out in battle array and shouting the war cry. So it's like kind of, ugh, right? Hey, yeah, right? Give me an I, give me an S. Yeah, all right. And it's like, yeah, but we all know we're scared to fight this guy, right? Then David left the baggage in the care of the baggage keeper and ran to the battle line. So he goes up to where the guys are dug in, and he entered to greet his brothers, and he was talking with them. Behold, while he was talking, the old Goliath shows up and starts doing his thing, right? Saying his thing. And as he was talking with them, behold, the champion, the Philistine from Gath, named Goliath, was coming up to the army of the Philistines, and he spoke these same words, and David heard them. When all the men of Israel saw the man, they all kind of, you know, get lower in their trenches and stuff, and they're like, yikes. And the men of Israel said, have you seen this guy who's coming up? Surely he's coming up to defy Israel. And it will be that the king will enrich the man who kills him with great riches and give him his daughter and make his fathers free in Israel. That means they don't have to pay taxes anymore. A lot of Californians go, I might as well, right? I have really no option here. Like, it's like killed by Goliath or rolled over by the Texans. And then David spoke to the men who were standing by saying, wait. Say this again. What's going to be done for the man who kills this Philistine and takes away the reproach of Israel? Here's David. For who is this uncircumcised? I love how he goes there, right? Who's this uncircumcised Philistine that's cracking on the living God, the armies of the living God? And the people answered in one accord, saying, this is what will be done for them. Now, this is one of the ways that you know the Bible is authentic and true and is the real word of God. Story, like what you're about to read. Ready? Here we go. Now Eliab, his oldest brother. Now how many of you have a brother? Raise your hand if you've got a brother. How many of you is that your older brother? If you have an older brother, raise your hand. Right, how many of you have a younger brother? Keep your hand up if you have an annoying younger brother, right? They're all annoying, right? All of them. So this is, I love this, like I can't even tell you how much I love this. Okay, so Eliab, his oldest brother, overheard when David was saying, hey, what will be done for the man who kills the Philistine? So here's this guy, this kid shows up. Everybody's afraid. He's like, hey, yeah, how come nobody's gonna fight this guy? Hey, what happens if somebody wins in this thing? And Eliab, his older brother, heard when he spoke to the men. And Eliab's anger burned against David. And he said this is so perfect. Why have you even come down here? And with whom have you left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know your insolence and the wickedness of your heart, for you've just come down to see the battle. And David said, now this is, okay, again, this is real, right? David says, what are you doing now? It's just a question, right? How many of you have said that? Dude, I'm just asking a question. Can't I even ask a question? Isn't that like, dude, that's what you write for real stories, right? It's not, verily I say unto you, all God's people. No, it's like, you little puke, what are you even doing here? And he's like, dude, I'm just asking a question. What are you doing here? That's a better question, right? Then he turned away. So finally the word gets to Saul that somebody is willing to go fight this guy. And Saul says, sweet, bring him. So he shows up, and Saul said to David, this is classic. And this is why his brother didn't like him, because David said to Saul, when he finally gets brought into his presence, let no man's heart fail on account of him. Don't be afraid. I got this. Your servant will go and fight with the Philistine. I don't know why you guys are freaking out. You should have just called me in the first place. I'm ready to go. And Saul looks at him, and David's still got a kid body. He's 16, maybe 17. And so it's like, dude. And Saul said, you're not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him. You're just a kid. And he's been killing people since he was a kid. David said, "Your servant was tending his father's sheep. When a lion or a bear came and took the lamb from the flock," most people would have said, "Well, you know, that's the cost of doing business. Live to fight another day." He says, "But what I did, I went after him and I attacked him and I rescued the sheep from the mouth of the lion or the bear and rose up. And when he rose up against me, I seized him by the beard and struck him and killed him. Your servant has killed both lion and bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them since he has taunted the armies of the living God." Here's another little principle, and this is huge. Huge, huge, huge. The anointed script is lived when no one is looking most of the time. See, when I say anointed script, you think of David and Goliath and the story, and yeah, great, right? But there's a lot. David says, before this thing that everybody is going to see and know and write stories about, there were things when nobody was looking. There was stuff happening when nobody was looking. Most of the anointed script is about you walking with God in the moment, in the mundane, in the regular life, about you experiencing the presence of God when no one's looking. It's kind of like David was thinking like this: well, God is with me even when others are not. I've learned that. See, in the mundane moments, you learn that. And danger is only danger, right? David is saying, if you factor God out. And think about this. David was also saying, and how about this attitude for a guy who's going to be the king? I care about sheep. Vulnerable, valuable, defenseless sheep. In other words, I heroically live the anointed script when it's no big deal and when no one's looking at me. So, here I've got this other slide section here. Think about this. His dad, it's like his brothers, the other soldiers, the lion and the bear, right? They all, Saul, the king, the current king, and Goliath, they're all pushing the old script on David. Stick to your eighth son, loser, your eighth son script. You doing this makes no sense. Why don't you just live to fight another day? I mean, they're just words. The guy's up there insulting God, but, you know, it's just words. Why do you care? Dude, let's be smart here. But they all had a colossal miscalculation. They were factoring God out. When David finally does go, "Let's get it on," and Saul goes, "All right, God be with you." And David goes down and gets his stones from the dry creek there and comes at Saul and comes at Goliath. Goliath is like, "What do you do? What? What am I, some kind of a little dog you're trying to chase away with this?" And David says, "No, you come with javelin and all this high-tech armor. I'm coming to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies. I've lived and am living a different script." All right. And you know how that works, right? It worked. So here's the what about me part. You might think, yeah, but I'm not a king. Like, Ed, you forget there's eight brothers. Seven of them didn't get oil poured on their heads. That's me, right? I'm that guy. I'm not oil on head guy. I am brother that God says, nope guy. I can feel it, man. If you knew my past, if you knew how bad I've screwed up, man, maybe at one time God might have poured the oil on my head, but now it's too late. You forget when you say that, when you think that, because I think that sometimes. You think, yeah, I could really use an upgraded script, but I don't know. Here's the deal. It starts with when Jesus, ready? This is the part we started with, remember? When Jesus interrupts our broken scripts with his grace. Okay, it's about to get better. As good as that is, For example, one of the great, this, by the way, look at, see that? Look, ready? Look at the screen. Everybody, look at the screen. That's the Bible. That's the New Testament in a line right there. If you want to add, if somebody ever asks you, so what's the Bible about? You could say, it's about Jesus interrupting our broken scripts with his grace. That's what it's about. All of us have broken scripts. All of us have mangled our script, and Jesus interrupts our script and goes, no, you're not going to keep living that. I've got a different script for you, and I'm about to give. There's so many verses I could show you. Here's one of my favorites, Romans 5:8. It says that God demonstrates his love toward us in that, listen, while we were still sinners and are living the broken script, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Give us the next verse there. He says, much more than having been justified by the blood of Jesus, we shall be saved from the wrath of God through him. Give me another verse. Look at this. Look at interruption. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son. Here's the thing. You might not know this, but before you connect with Jesus, you have made yourself an enemy of God. And God says, but I love my enemies. And so I'm going to interrupt your enemy script, your broken script. Well, much more, once you've come into relationship with Christ, much more having been reconciled, will be saved by his very life. How cool is that, right? So here's how he does it. Ready? He puts us in Christ and says, now we get to live. Listen, you might be Eliab or Abinadab or one of the ones that you think you've got passed over. But now when you connect with Jesus, he says, here, your script is the anointed script. Let me show you something, how this works. Have you missed your weekly Hebrew lesson? Here we go. All right. So the word, when Samuel anoints him, pours oil on his head, is this word here, Meshach. Meshach. It's that letter, that H that's like I've got a sinus infection, Meshach, right? But here's a little thing. The word for the Messiah, what Messiah means in Hebrew is, or not what it means, the word is HaMashiach. Can you hear the same? Yes, hear it? HaMashiach, right? Which means the anointed one. And then, when you get to the New Testament and they start writing in Greek, because that's what everybody in the world speaks, they say, HaMashiach, what's the Greek word for that? Christos, Christ, the anointed one. Ready? Loop's about to close. You're about to go, whoa, that's cool. Ready? So when the Bible says, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Jesus comes into your life and says, all right, now let's live the anointed script. You get his script. Bam! How awesome is that? I love what Will said last week. Jesus isn't here to just motivate you. He's like, I'll get in you and help you and give you power. My anointed script can start today. So let's pray. I want to just have a moment of script receival right now. Maybe it would help you to lay your hands on your lap and turn your palms up just as like a receiving thing. If you've trusted Jesus, listen, if you've trusted Jesus, then you live, you get to live, you are called to live the anointed script. You are the one with, because you're in him and he's in you. Because you know, the one of the main titles of Jesus was, right? The Son of David. If you haven't trusted Jesus, why don't you trust him right now? Why don't you accept him into your life? Put your trust in him. Believe in him. Believe that he died for you. Just tell him right now, Jesus, I want you to come into my life. Let me live the script that I'm destined to live, the anointed script. Would you just pray this with me right now? All of you that have accepted Jesus, would you just pray right this minute? God, I receive the anointed script. And just, even if you don't feel like this, I want you to boldly say it. That's who I am. All right, let's worship together. Why don't you stand up with us? Go ahead, everybody standing up. Let's bring everything we can.
Speak in vain, you're still the believer.
could chase down my heart through all of my failure and pride. On a hill you created the light of the world, abandoned in darkness to die. And as you speak, 100 billion failures disappear. Where you lost your life so I could find it here. If you left the grave behind you so
victory. Our praise will rise to Christ our King.
resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting.
Yeah, yes and amen. I don't know about you guys, but I don't want to stop worshiping. Yeah, that is cool. Hey, we're going to do some more worship on this coming up week with Nights of Prayer. I got a couple things to share with you before you leave. Feel free to stand, sit down, whatever you want. One thing I probably shouldn't share with you, but last night I actually had a dream, and I was in a room like this with a bunch of people. I was just singing like so loud, belting out the name of Jesus. So let's hope for all your sake that's not prophetic. I won't be leading worship at the Nights of Worship this weekend, this week. But two things to let you know before we leave. One is we're going to have a blood drive next Sunday right here in our parking lot. And we're encouraging you to sign up for that instead of just walk in. You can walk in, but we'd rather have you sign up for that. And there's free stuff for those who are donors. So you want to take note of that. And then, as Ed mentioned, next week is the week of prayer. So a couple things about that. First is We've got 50 spots still available for the hour of prayer. So hop online, hop on the app, grab your hour. Let's get those all covered. Second, we've got the nights of prayer Tuesday through Thursday at 6:30. Lots of variety, different theme every night. So check those out Tuesday through Thursday. And then last, we're going to have like real journey people, not people like me, like staff, but real journey peeps like you guys writing prayers Monday through Friday. And we're going to post those on our Journey Prayer Practices Facebook page this week. So check that out. And if you haven't liked it yet, make sure to find it. It's Journey Prayer Practices. And you'll know you're on the right page if you see Ed at the top. So Journey Prayer Practices Facebook page. That's it, Journey. Have a great week. We're going to see you next Sunday. And don't forget, there's prayer right over here in the corner. So head right there if you want to get some prayer. And we'll see you next Sunday. All right. Thanks, Journey.